of the Holy Family, the perfect family, the image of the perfect family, Mary, the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, and the child, Jesus. And Saint Luke tells us a continuation of the Christmas story by telling us what happened when Mary and her husband Joseph brought the baby Jesus to the temple. Now, Saint Luke is telling us some very important things. One of the things Saint Luke, who wrote this Holy Gospel, and then later the Acts of the Apostles, he likes to emphasize how the temple is the source of the spiritual life of Israel. And so the story of the Nativity in St. Luke begins in the temple when the father of John the Baptist, do you remember the name of the father of John the Baptist? His name is Zechariah. I know you knew that. Then Zechariah is performing his duties as a high priest in the temple, and the angel Gabriel appears to him and says, you will be the father of a son, and he will be blessed in a very special way, and that son will be John the Baptist. And his wife conceives. His wife's name is Elizabeth, and she conceived. How did she conceive? The usual way. Anyway, and 9 months later, she gave birth to John the Baptist. Now, the story of Christmas, the Nativity of Jesus, then continues with the angel Gabriel going to Mary and saying, "Hail, full of grace, the Lord is with you. You have found favor with God, and you will conceive and bear in your womb a son." You know, et cetera. We went through this already before Christmas. Anyway, and she makes a beautiful canticle. She says, "Let it be done to me according to your will." And then she goes to meet Elizabeth. She goes on a journey to Judea to meet Elizabeth. And there's a wonderful meeting there. And the meeting happens filled with the Holy Spirit. This is another important point for Saint Luke. Saint Luke emphasizes the Holy Spirit. And then we go to, and that's when Mary sings this beautiful canticle, "My soul magnifies the Lord. He has cast down the mighty from their thrones. He will raise up the lowly." That's another theme in Saint Luke about God saving and those who are humble and who cry out to him in their need. Then is the birth of Jesus. And the birth of Jesus we celebrated on Monday when there was a star that led the shepherds. The shepherds went to the manger, and there they saw as the angel had said. The angel said, "And as a sign, you will see a child wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." Now, what is a manger? A manger is where animals eat. Would you put your baby in a manger? No, you all look like pretty good people. You probably wouldn't do that. But there was no place in the inn, and that's the only option they had. And Mary gave birth right there in the barn, and Jesus was laid in the manger. And that's when the shepherds come, and they tell Joseph and Mary everything that they knew, that they had heard from the angel.
Now, today continues that. Mary and Joseph, presumably they're not living in the barn anymore. They've probably found some better place to stay. Maybe they went to Bethany. Jesus had some good friends when he was grown up. Maybe that was where they went. Maybe Joseph and Mary knew the parents of Lazarus, Mary, and Martha. Maybe Lazarus, Mary, and Martha were already born and were thrilled to see Mary and love Jesus even from the moment that he was introduced to them. They were good friends, certainly in Jesus' adulthood. So maybe they were staying there, but whatever the case was, an angel then tells Joseph, flee, take the mother and the child, and flee to Egypt, because Herod, more about Herod in a second, he didn't want to be married to Herod. Herod was jealous, had heard from the wise men of the birth of the king of Israel, and had sent his soldiers to murder every child 2 years and younger. So then they flee. So here's the Holy Family. The Holy Family, they had a lot of pressures on them. Where do so many pressures come from? They come from the unknown. And we don't know that much about the future. Who knew that there was going to be a census and that everybody was going to have to go to the home of their ancestor? Who knew about that? Joseph and Mary, very pregnant, make that long journey. It's not unfamiliar to them. They've done it all their lives. They make their journey to Bethlehem. And then, then they can't find a place to stay. So Joseph must have felt panicked, worried about that. What father worries about his children being born? You know, will I get my wife to the hospital on time? You know, will everything work out well? Many times it doesn't. Well, here's a case like that, and Saint Joseph was pressured and worried, and things didn't work out the way he imagined that they should. Anyway, and then later on they have to flee the country to save the child from Herod. Well, let's talk about families for a little bit. Are you ready? Families. We all come from families, like it or not. We come from families. My family, I was nervous all the time as a kid. I had three older brothers. Your brothers told me that you're their brother. Brothers are supposed to be very welcoming of their little brothers. Mine loved to tease and to pull tricks on me, and that's why I like this. Anyway, families are supposed to be, ideally, are supposed to be places where a child's gifts are discovered and discerned, and they're nurtured, and a child grows into a competent grown-up, that they're able to live lives that make the world better for other people. But that doesn't happen. A lot of us come from families where we dream about running away to join the circus or something, to try and find a better life. Let me swallow swords or something, anything. But if that is a perfect family where our gifts are nurtured and we grow up to be real contributors as citizens who make wherever we live better for everyone else, the opposite would be a family like where your father was Charles or you know, the family on the opposite end of the spectrum would be where there's, you know, prison and restraining orders and violence. And the unfortunate fact about our life is that that horrible extreme that nobody wants to think about is very common in our world, that there are families where the children and the members of the family grow up under the heavy weight of the threat of violence every day. And that affects the children. Now, hopefully, our families are way in the middle range. We have some really good things. We have some things we like to tell people. I come from an Irish family, but there are lots of secrets. But anyway, we grow up, and hopefully we come to meet in God and His Son, Jesus Christ, a great deal of mercy and forgiveness, and that Jesus gives us new life, and that Jesus welcomes us into His family. It doesn't eliminate our family, and a lot of our family may reject our looking to God for this life where we're welcomed, imperfect though we are, sometimes guilty of having done terrible, terrible things, and yet God welcomes sinners, sinners who want to be forgiven and to be merciful and forgiving to others, sinners who come, like we do, to be fed with the Word of God and with the body and blood of Christ. Where we look forward to heaven, where we will be healed eternally. It's a long, long journey, and we're on that journey. So, our families aren't perfect, but we ask that God would help us see in the holy family, the family that had a lot of extreme situations, that we would be able to find in them light, and that we would find ourselves part of that holy family. Finally, that scene in the temple, Mary and Joseph bringing the child Jesus. These two strange characters, Simeon, a man who, in the Holy Spirit, again, here's another theme of St. Luke, the Holy Spirit in the temple. And Simeon had been told by the Holy Spirit, you will not die until you see the promised Messiah, the Christ of God. And so he goes into the temple, now inspired by the Spirit, and he takes the baby Jesus in his hands, and he sings to God, now you can let me go in peace, for my own eyes have seen the salvation of Israel. And then he turns to Mary, the mother of Jesus, and he says to her something very awful. He said, and you, a sword will pierce your heart. A sword will pierce you through. And we know that literally that didn't happen. But figuratively, of course, what mother doesn't, and what father too, doesn't suffer dreadfully when bad things happen to their children. And Mary, who is the mother of sorrows, she understands our sorrows because she stood helpless at the foot of the cross. And in Michelangelo's great masterpiece, when he was such a young man, Michelangelo was only about 24 when he carved the Pietà. And he poses Mary, serene and contemplating the death of her son, who she holds in her arms. but certainly the sword of suffering and of sorrow, pierces a mother's heart. We may not have been perfect children growing up. We may cause a lot of sorrow for our parents, but it's never too late to tell God that we need healing for our families, that we need healing in our own hearts, and that this holy family becomes a place where we come so that we may bear the light of the child Jesus. Jesus who was born so that sinners may be saved. It's wonderful news that Jesus is born, but the good news, the really good news, the gospel, is that by his birth and by his passion, his death and his resurrection, we too can be sharers in becoming the children of God. And we find salvation in that. This is the family that encompasses the whole world and draws us as an offering to God to praise him forever.